AP 120, Chapter 16, Topics, Factors That Affect Breathing. So normally, our normal breathing is a calm, rhythmic activity that is involuntary. We don't have to consciously think about breathing. We are able to do that automatically, although we can voluntarily control the muscles related to breathing. Now, there are respiratory areas in the brainstem that help to control breathing. They cause the inspiration and expiration to occur, and they adjust the rate and depth of breathing depending on the needs of the body. So we have the medullary rhythmicity center found in the medulla oblongata, and it includes the ventral respiratory group, which controls the basic rhythm of breathing, the in and out, in and out. And the dorsal respiratory group that stimulates the respiratory muscles that directly control the diaphragm and external intercostal muscles. Then in the pons, we have the pontine respiratory group, and its job is to limit inspiration, to prevent us from overinflating and damaging our lungs. So no matter how deep you try to breathe in, how hard you try to breathe in, you cannot breathe in so deeply that you damage your lungs. So pontine respiratory group influences the medullary respiratory center, which controls the respiratory muscles to allow us to breathe in and out in a nice rhythmic manner and to affect the rate and depth of breathing depending on whether we're taking a nap or running a marathon. There are various factors that affect breathing. Besides the respiratory areas in the brain, chemicals, specifically chemicals in the blood. So what is going on in the bloodstream can affect our breathing. The stretch limits of the lung tissue, so we can only breathe in so deep. Our emotional state, having an anxiety attack, will definitely affect your rate of breathing. And of course, our relative health. So chemosensitive areas. These are regions in the brain that are receiving information about the concentration of carbon dioxide and hydrogen ions in the bloodstream. And it's monitoring carbon dioxide levels and hydrogen ions that allow the body to know how hard or slow, how fast or slow we need to breathe. So where does the carbon dioxide in blood originally come from? Hope you said cellular metabolism. Our cells are always producing carbon dioxide as they are producing ATP for the cells to function. Now, it turns out that when you have high levels of carbon dioxide or high levels of hydrogen ions, you end up having a low pH. So the blood becomes more acidic when you increase the amounts of carbon dioxide or increase the amounts of hydrogen ions. And when this happens, the chemoreceptors send a signal to the brain, and the brain says, uh-oh, and they will increase the breathing rate. So by breathing in faster, more carbon dioxide gets released into the air that we exhale, and carbon dioxide levels in the blood will go down. So again, when you get high levels of carbon dioxide or the blood becomes more acidic, then you breathe in faster, getting rid of extra carbon dioxide from the bloodstream, lowering carbon dioxide levels, and also lowering hydrogen ion levels and raising the pH. And of course, when you have the opposite occur, you will breathe slower. So when there are low carbon dioxide levels in the blood or low hydrogen ion levels, then the pH of the blood is rising, so the pH is becoming more basic or more alkaline. This is also bad. We need a narrow range of pH for the blood. So the information reaches the brain. The brain says, uh-oh, we need to decrease the breathing rate, to breathe slower. Breathe slower, you release less carbon dioxide. And since carbon dioxide is always being produced and added to blood, this will allow the carbon dioxide levels in the blood to go up, which would also increase hydrogen ion levels, which would raise the pH. I'm sorry, which would lower the pH. More hydrogen ions, lower pH. And of course, this also affects the cerebral spinal fluid because the cerebral spinal fluid is made from blood. So the pH of the blood is basically the same pH as the cerebral spinal fluid. And the first structure to be damaged by abnormal pHs, whether too high or too low, is the nervous tissue, the brain and spinal cord. So we also are keeping track of the chemical composition of the cerebral spinal fluid, which will also affect breathing rates. So blood pH, cerebral spinal fluid pH, those are all very important, controlled by the amounts of carbon dioxide and the amount of hydrogen ions. So hyperventilation, breathing in very in and out very rapidly. Well, when you breathe in and out very rapidly, you will lose more carbon dioxide. So you will lower the amount of carbon dioxide in the blood. This will then lower the amount of hydrogen ions in the blood, which would then raise blood pH, making the blood more alkaline, which would also make the cerebral spinal fluid more alkaline, raise its pH as well. Now, if you are engaging in uncontrolled hyperventilation, or you just really want to try to pass out, by breathing in and out very fast, eventually the body says, no, you got to slow down. And if you're not going to slow down consciously, then the body causes you to slow down by making you faint. So hyperventilation, uncontrolled hyperventilation, will lead to the person fainting. And the way we try to counter this is by having the person breathe in and out of a paper bag. Make sure it's paper. And what happens is that increases the level of carbon dioxide in the air they're breathing in and out, which would then make it slow down the loss of carbon dioxide and hopefully prevent them from fainting. So you also can, of course, hyperventilate on your own, consciously breathe in and out really rapidly. And what will happen is, because this will lower your carbon dioxide levels in your bloodstream, it'll allow you to hold your breath longer. So the next time you're in a see who can breathe, hold your breath the longest contest, first hyperventilate briefly before holding your breath. How does this work? Well, we have a certain level of carbon dioxide that when it gets to that level, our body says, you need to breathe now. If you start at the normal levels of carbon dioxide in your bloodstream, then it takes a certain amount of time to get to the point from holding your breath that the body says you must breathe now. So again, if you start from normal breathing and hold your breath, there's a certain amount of time for the carbon dioxide levels to increase enough to cause you to want to breathe really, really badly. Now, if you hyperventilate, you lower the amount of carbon dioxide in your bloodstream. So now you're starting at a lower level, hold your breath. It takes longer to reach the level of carbon dioxide that causes you to really, really want to breathe. So again, hyperventilation lowers carbon dioxide levels, letting you hold your breath longer. Kind of weird, huh? All right, peripheral chemoreceptors are checking for other factors in the blood, specifically oxygen concentration. In general, low oxygen levels are not a huge deal because we're really efficient at getting oxygen into the bloodstream. But there are chemoreceptors, there are receptors in the major arteries that are letting the brain know what the oxygen level is. And if the oxygen level gets too low, then that will increase breathing rate and breathing depth. So if your oxygen levels get too low, you'll breathe harder and faster. Again, carbon dioxide concentrations have much more greater effect on breathing rates than oxygen levels, but oxygen is important enough to have receptors devoted to it. So again, oxygen levels must be extremely low to stimulate this effect because we're really efficient at using oxygen. All right, other factors. There's an inflation reflex. So this is just a reflex that prevents us from overstretching the lungs. So no matter how hard you try to breathe in, you cannot breathe in so much that you will overinflate your lungs unless you use some accessory device to cause it to happen, and that would hurt, so don't do that. And that is it for this part of the lecture.